Hello everyone, welcome back. This is Ruthi Dheria with the third lecture on Code of Civil Procedure 1908. Before starting, firstly, I would like to apologize for all the audio issues that were there with the lecture two. I hope this lecture will be free from all such audio issues. Secondly, this video was actually supposed to go up on YouTube yesterday, but due to certain issues, I could not record the lecture yesterday, so this would be going up today. And thirdly, a very big thank you for all the positive responses that you guys have given me. And I really hope that I can continue to live up to the expectations that have been set by now. And lastly, one important thing, the most important thing before we can start off with today's topics is that this entire series was mostly designed keeping the Bihar judiciary prelims in mind. However, I would also like to clarify that I do know that CPC does not form a major chunk of the Bihar judiciary prelims, but another main motive that I had behind choosing CPC as a subject for creating the course was that there is a huge lot of fear and stigma attached with this subject. I feel there is a lot of hue and cry that CPC is too complex, etc. So, In all honesty, the main reason was that I really wanted to remove that stigma. So if you feel that the courses are too exhaustive considering the prelims, etc., I really don't mean it as the main purpose. I really hope that with this course, after doing this, going through this course, you are no longer scared of CPC and you can actually go in and read any other books and can understand all concepts easily. So, I also hope that the last two lectures have been okay with the content and otherwise, except for the audio issues in the lecture two. So, in the last classes, we had covered res judicata, res sub judice, and we had covered res judicata, res sub judice. Then we had gone on bar of suit. Then suits of civil nature, jurisdiction, then place of suing, the jurisdiction table, the objections to jurisdiction, foreign court and foreign judgments. I know last class became a little long, but I'll try to make today's class a lot more precise. So today what we'll be dealing with is institution of suits, first of all, then what are the parties to the suit, and then we'll be dealing with frame of suit. Set readings we'll be keeping for the next class. So, starting off with institution of suits, hopefully there's no problem in the last lecture with the concepts of res judicata, res sub judice, and the other such concepts. If there is, please let me know in the comment sections. We can go back to those concepts as well. So there's a behind my designing of this course was that in the first class we dealt about the introduction and the history portion. In the second class we dealt about concepts of res sub judice, res judicata, so that we could understand why, so that we could get a background there. Then we first understood the jurisdiction, so that we can understand where we have to actually go and institute a suit. Now, as you have understood the jurisdiction, what do we mean by foreign judgment, foreign court, and all those concepts, we can come to institution of suits. Now, first thing, what do we mean by suits? That when we were reading the decree, I think the definition of suits started off from there. When we were reading decree, we had said that the proceeding should be in a suit. The proceeding in question should be a suit. So what is a suit? Suit is not actually anywhere properly defined in the court. You won't find the definition of a suit in section 2. But in general, you can understand that suit is a proceeding which is beginning with a plaint. So what is there in every suit? Every suit will at least have two opposing parties. There will be a subject matter in dispute. There will be a cause of action and there'll be a relief. So there must be two parties that are opposing each other. There must be something that is in dispute, and whatever is in dispute, there must be some reason behind that dispute. And thirdly, you must be asking for some relief or some prayer from the court. Now, these four points, whenever you are writing what is a suit, you can write that these are the essentials of a suit. Now, what are the relevant sections or provisions under CPC? That would be section 26 and order 4. What does section 26 verse say? Now, section 26, where are we getting the definition that suit is a proceeding that begins with a plaint? It is under section 26, that suit is always instituted by a presentation of a plaint. And what should be there with the plaint? That the facts, whatever we are stating in the plaint, it should be supported by an affidavit. And what do we mean by an affidavit? Now, affidavit, if some of you must have seen some pleadings or any such legal document, any such document, you must have seen an affidavit. What is an affidavit? There you are declaring certain facts. How? That have been reduced to writing and that has been affirmed or sworn before an officer who has an authority, who has the authority to administer oaths. And an affidavit is always made in first person. You'll see it is written, I solemnly affirm, etc. It should contain statements, not inferences. You shouldn't write, I think so. It is what it is. You're not writing, this might be the case, that might be the case, this is a probability, not like that. So section 26 first is telling you that the suit is always instituted by presentation of a plaint and the facts in the plaint should always be proved by an affidavit. And what is an affidavit? Here I have given the definition. Affidavit is also not defined in the definition clause. Now, as I said, that order 4. Now, from here, we are seeing the correlation starting between orders in the section. Now, order 4 is talking about the institution suits. Order 4, rule 1 is saying that whenever we are submitting a plaint, it should be submitted in duplicate by whom? The persons themselves or the advocate or any other person that they have recognized. And whenever we are drafting that plaint, we should follow the rules that are given under orders 6 and 7. Otherwise, we will not assume, it will not be taken, the suit would not be taken as properly instituted. And order 4 rule 2 is saying that every court maintains a register of suits, which is maintained according to the dates. According to the dates on which the suits are filed, otherwise they are maintaining a register of suits. So this is your first topic, that is institution of suits. You have to remember, first, the section number, order number 26, order 4 starts with the plaint supported by an affidavit. What is an affidavit? What are the four essentials of a suit? And what does the order say? That it should be in duplicate by whom? Which party should be given? What are the two orders that need to be followed by drafting a plaint? And order 4 rule 2 is telling you about the register of the suits maintained by the court. Now, moving on to the next topic, that is the parties to the suit. Now, the way I'm moving forward is first understand how we are instituting it. Then you have to understand who are the parties to it. And then we'll talk about how the suit is being framed. And then we'll move on to the pleadings. So, parties to the suit, here the relevant order would be order 1, that is talking about the parties to the suit. Now, here we'll start. Here you'll be talking about the joinder parts, non-joinder, misjoinder, etc. So the first thing we'll do is we'll read rule 1 and rule 3 together. Why we'll do so, you'll understand now. Now, rule 1 is talking about joinder of plaintiffs and rule 3 is talking about joinder of defendants. Now, what is joinder of plaintiffs? Joinder of plaintiffs means when two or one or more plaintiffs come together in a suit. Now, when we are reading this rule, you have to see there are two conditions that are given, that when can two plaintiffs come together or more than two plaintiffs can come together and file a suit. There are two conditions that are given and both should be satisfied, that it is an and clause. It is not an or clause. Mere satisfaction of one condition would not be enough. Both of them should be satisfied. So the first condition for any joinder of plaintiffs in a case is that there should be any right of relief which is arising or is in respect of same act or series of act or transactions which exists in such persons jointly, severally, or in the alternative. First thing is that there should be a right of relief which is residing in such persons either jointly or severally or in the alternative. And the right of relief in respect of such persons must be arising out of what kind of an act? It should be either the same act or the same series of acts or transactions. This is the first condition. Right of relief should be arising out of same act or series of transactions and it should exist in them jointly or severally or in the alternative. And the second thing is that how do we understand that a joinder can take place here is that if separately all these people had taken a suit, had gone for separate individual suits, a common question of either law or fact would have arisen. So for joinder of plaintiffs, there should be a right of relief, which is arising or in respect of the same act or series of acts or transactions that exists in such persons jointly or severally, or in the alternative. And secondly, if all these persons are individually brought a suit, a common question of law or fact would have arisen. Now, why did I say that we'll be reading it with Rule 3 for joinder of defendants? This is because for joinder of defendants also, the same two conditions should be there, only that relief should be against them. The suit should be brought against them. That is the only difference. So if you're writing for joinder defendants, here you'll be writing if a separate suit was brought against them, any common question of law or fact would have arisen. And here you will write any right or relief in respect or arising would be existing against such persons jointly, separately, or in the alternative. This is why we read rule number one and rule number three together. This is about joinder of plaintiffs. I hope that is understood here. So the next thing is that what happens, what is the rule? So after we have understood joinder of plaintiffs and joinder of defendants, we can move forward to the next rule, that is rule 2 and rule 3A. Again, we are reading them together. Rule 2 is in respect of the plaintiff. Rule 3A is in respect of the defendant. Now what happens is that if at any time the court is feeling that this joinder that has taken place is embarrassing or delaying the trial, or for any other reason it feels that it is not serving the purpose as intended, the court has the power to order separate trials or make any other order that it seems expedient. Now I hope that is understood. So we have seen rule 1, rule 2, rule 3 and rule 3. Now we can go forward to rule 4. Now rule 4 is a rule that is trying to give you the explanation that does it mean that if we have 10 defendants in a case, all the reliefs that are given by the court or all the prayers that have been accepted by the court, all the reliefs that have been granted against the defendants, all should be applicable on all of them, or all the plaintiffs should get the same relief? That is not the case. Rule number 4 says that the plaintiff, that the court can give relief in such case only for one or more plaintiff, or only against one or more defendant as it deems fit. For example, I added on 10 people whom I felt that they owe me some amount. When the suit was decreed, it was found that only 5 of them were liable to pay me the money, the rest were not. So the relief was only given against 5 of them. That is allowed. Joinder does not mean that against all of the same relief should be given. Now, next thing is, again, Rule 5 is telling you that it is not necessary that every defendant in such a case should be interested in the entire relief that has been claimed in any suit against him. Now, moving forward is Rule 6, where we are talking about the persons who are liable on the same contract. Then, plaintiffs can join all or any such persons in a same suit. If there are persons who are liable severally or jointly and severally in the same suit, which includes parties to a bill of exchange, hundis, promissory notes, etc., then the plaintiffs can join all or any of such persons in the same suit. This is a special case where we are seeing where they can be joined. You do not really, in such case, in the situations mentioned in rule number 6, it is not required that you need to fulfill the conditions of rule 3 also. Then rule 7, when a plaintiff is in doubt, for example, I do not know whom should I address, whom should I take my readdress, he may join all those peoples against whom he has confusion, and the liability on whom and to what extent can be decided by the court. So these are the first 7 rules. Now we come to a very important concept in the parties to a suit. There are 2 kinds of parties in a suit. First is a necessary party and a proper party. Necessary party, by the words itself, you might be getting a hint what it is. Necessary parties, the presence is indispensable. Without them, no effective decree will be passed. proper parties. With the, in the absence also you can pass an effective degree, but however the final decision for it to be complete and final, their presence is needed. For example, we can take partition suits without involving all the sharers. They cannot be an effective partition. That is why the part all the sharers become a necessary party. Now the second thing is that how when can you see a proper party? For example, if the government has acquired certain land for giving it to a particular corporation, and it has acquired my land, so I move to the court that the acquisition has been wrongly done. In that case, the corporation becomes a proper party because mainly the dispute is between me and the government. It is between me and the government. So the presence of the corporation is not really that indispensable, but however, because its interests are being affected, so for its complete and a final decision, that corporation also becomes a proper party. Now, next we are talking about important concept of misjoinder and non-joinder. Now, misjoinder and non-joinder will not prevent. There's a rule given that if there is a misjoinder, or if by mistake some wrong party has been added or somebody has not been added, that does not prevent the court from actually dealing with the controversy matters which are before it with regards to the parties which are before it. However, there was a proviso added. But if there is a non-joinder of necessary party, the court cannot proceed. This is why I had explained the distinction between necessary and a proper party. Now, Rule 13, which goes on to state, is that whatever objections anybody has to take as to non-joinder and misjoinder, you have to take it at the earliest, otherwise it will be deemed to be waived. Now, moving on is the 10th rule, which was talking about how you add, delete, and substitute a party. For example, if a suit has been instituted in the wrong name of a wrong plaintiff, or there's a doubt whether it has been instituted in the correct name or not, the court has a may power, that is a discretionary power, that at any stage, if it is feeling that it has been due to a bona fide mistake, and for determining the real matter, it can add or substitute a party. Okay? An addition or a substitution can be done. And at any stage, court, by an application of either of the parties or on its own, can order striking out of the parties or add any party which it feels that is needed for complete and full adjudication. Now, what happens now, for example, if a defendant is added, the plaint will be amended and the amended copies of the summons have to be given to the new defendant. And if the court says so, you have to also provide it to the old defendants. Now, when with the proceedings deemed to be begun for the new defendant who has been added, it will be deemed to be begun from the date of the service of the summons. Now, till now, we have seen around a number of rules. So I hope there is no confusion. First, we are starting that how can you join parties? How can you join parties as plaintiffs or defendants? How the court has power to remove them if it feels it is delay? Look at it logically. Don't take it too technically. You might need to join a party as plaintiff or as a defendant. You might find that the joinder, the court might find that it is causing unnecessary trouble. So the court should have some power to remove them. Then it does not mean that if you're joining all of them, the court will give relief against all of them also, or every defendant should be interested in the entire relief. Then their special situation is given, that where you do not need to strictly follow rule one or three, when you're trying to join persons, that in the case of when they are liable on the same contract or the parties to a bill of exchange, hundis or promissory notes, you can join them if they're severally or jointly and severally liable. And then 7 is also giving a situation where you are confused against whom you have to take redress, and you can join all such parties and then liability can be decided. Then we also understood the important concepts of necessary party and proper party. And you understand that Rule 9 does say that misjoinder and non-joinder does not prevent the court. However, non-joinder of a necessary party will not allow the court to proceed. And as everything, if you have any objection that a certain necessary party has not been joined or there has been a misjoinder that has taken place, then you should take it at the earliest opportunity. Now, because there has been, now we have talked about joinders, so there should be some part where there can be additions, deletions or substitutions. So Rule 10 is dealing with all of that we have seen. Now, Rule 8 is talking about the representative suit. Now, what is a representative suit? simple language. In very simple language, you can understand that where a lot of people are interested. For example, there's a particular plot of land. It is a piece of land which is a public land, which is where everybody, the entire housing colony is dependent on the public piece of land, but some particular outsider has come and encroached a particular piece of land. Now, all of those people are interested in the road, interested in the clearance of the road or the clearance of the encroachment. So numerous persons, they have a same interest in one suit. So now there are 100 people living in the housing society. It is not needed or all 100 of them will go to the court. One or more of the such persons can go to the court, and with the court's permission, they may say that on behalf of so many people, we are filing the suit. So rule number 8, an important rule, is talking about representative suit. When numerous persons who have the same interest in one suit, numerous persons having the same interest in one suit, where one or more persons with the court's permission can sue, be sued or defend on behalf of all such persons. This is when they are going by their own, or the court itself may direct that because the interest of so many people are involved, one or two of you may do so. Now, whenever such a permission for filing is given, when, for example, in the Rhodes case, if 3 people out of the colony, the housing colony, were given permission that, okay, now you can proceed with the court, with the suit in the court on behalf of everyone, then the plaintiff on his own expense has to give notice to all the interested persons. By how? We can give them individual personal service of letters can be done, or a public advertisement can be done if personal is not possible. Without notice, no representative suit can be filed. This is an essential. Now, any person on whose behalf this case has been filed, now out of 100 people, some of them feel that no, we should also be an actual party in this suit, or we should be also by name in the suit, they can apply to the court for being made a party. Secondly, because it is on behalf of so many people, the suit will not proceed on the will of the people, of the 2 or 3 or some people who are actually filing the suit. So you cannot abandon or compromise or agree or do any agreement in relation to such a suit without giving notice to all the persons. Secondly, it may be possible that out of the 100, the court might have chosen 3 people who are not doing the duty properly. So if the court feels that they are not doing it with due diligence, the court may substitute him with another person from the colony because he also has the same interest. Now, whatever decree is being passed here, it will be binding on all of them for whom it is instituted or on whose behalf it has been defended. So here we'll go back to section 11, explanation 6, where we were talking about a representative suit, that any such decree in such a suit being passed is binding on all of the persons interested. Now, what do we mean by same interest? Same interest means that the interest must be common. Different cause of action will not affect the right to file such a suit if the interest is same, and it is not required that the transaction should be same. This means that, for example, the chit fund frauds, etc., that happened, for example, one particular company has deceived so many people in different set of transactions. They all have the same interest. They want to recover money from that person. Now, there's a different cause of action because everyone has a different receipt on the basis of which they have given the money. The transaction is also not the same, but this will not bar them from coming for a representative suit because their interest remains the same. Now, the last part is that because it is a representative suit, in general, we see with the death of a party, the suit abates. Suit abates. Abatement, death, what happens, how death affects a suit, we'll see in later lectures. But here we are seeing that such a representative suit, the death of a party who's conducting the case will in no way abate the suit, as you can immediately substitute that person with another person. Now, Rule 8A is another important rule, that the court feels that if any person or persons are directly and substantially interested in any question of law, it's not a question of fact, but question of law, and public request requires them to be made a part, then court may permit them to come and express their opinion. So here we studied Order 1, where we understood about how joinders are being done, when we understood our jointures, we understood how we can remove them. We understood how what does relief need to be necessarily claimed against all, etc. Then we understood the on the same contract liability, bill of exchange, hundis, promissory notes, rule 6. Then we went on to rule 7, where we talked about when you are in doubt, when we talked about the kinds of parties in a suit. Then we saw what happens, what is the effect of non-jointure and misjointure in a suit. When are the objections to be taken? Rule 10 about the addition, deletion, and substitution of parties, and Rule 8 about the representative suit, and 8A. Now here, what this is a very important order, especially for those MCQs and also for the exams. Sometimes we go for the deeper concepts that we forget to actually go back to the main basics. So here, you can, this is an important order, because you can ask when can you join, they'll give you a situation that can these plaintiffs be joined in one suit, or they can give you a situation when can a representative suit be filed, they can give you certain situations, when can you add or delete a party, when can the objection be filed, they are liable on the same contract, can they be joined together as one, what is the effect of misjoinder and non-joinder of a party, all this will be answered by order 1, so this is quite an important order to be read. Now next we are going to is the framing of a suit. So how should you frame a suit? Now so the first thing that is there is the framing of the suit. The first rule that is telling here is that the suits should be framed in such a manner that you can understand that what are the grounds for the final decision. There should be not further litigation, should be preventing further litigation on the same subject. It should, so that it should be clear, it should have all of it together in one place. So logically also understand, if I am going to the court would also want to come with all your grievances at once. Don't come one by one. You, because that also not only wastes judicial time, but also is wasting your time, resources, etc. And it is also preventing too much of litigation to go on the same subjects. So suit should be framed in such a manner that it affords ground for final decision. Now on the same point, you see rule number 2 is also saying that the suit should include the entire claim. Now you, if you want that you are suing somebody for rupees 10,000, you should actually go forward and sue them for rupees 10,000, not only for 8,000. Now, if you are wanting to relinquish that part, like you're hoping that I do not, for example, the court you want to go to has a pecuniary limit of, for assume that's 5,000 rupees. You do not want to go to the higher forum. So you say, let's do one thing, let's split our claim and leave that 5,000. Let's relinquish it. You can relinquish that to adjust to the pecuniary jurisdiction of the court, etc. But however, you cannot go back, come back later and say that I relinquished it at that point and so I'm coming here. So you cannot split your cause of action first. Second, you have to claim all your reliefs. If you're omitting it, you can't sue for it later. Only if you're omitting it with the court's permission, you can sue on it later. However, no fresh suit can be filed on the same cause of action. Now, here you can see that what we are saying, as we understood, you have to give finality to it. You should include the entire claim. You should not relinquish it. If you are relinquishing it, you should not come back with it. Claim of all relief should be done. You should not omit it. Here, I would like you to recall, where did we study a similar type of provision under Section 11 in the explanations part also. You should go back and see that also. And no fresh suit should be filed on the same cause of action. Now, moving forward is the joinder of cause of actions. In order number 1, we were talking about joinder of the parties. Here, we are talking about the joinder of the cause of actions. When can you join several cause of actions? Now, a plaintiff can join against the same defendant, the defendants jointly in one suit, he can join several causes of action. Or if there are a lot of plaintiffs with these causes of action and they're jointly interested against the same defendants, they can join all of them together. And how will be the jurisdiction of such a court decided, what of such a suit decided, will depend on the aggregate value of the subject matter. So the first point here was telling you that if the plaintiff, one plaintiff against the same defendant, or against the same defendant. He has been defrauded by a lot. In different situations, he has been defrauded by a similar person or by a group of persons. He can join them together in one suit, and all those calls of actions can be joined. Now, plaintiffs, some more than one plaintiffs can join their cause of actions if they are jointly interested against the same defendants or defendants, and they can join them together in one of the suit. And how will you decide which court now you have to go? Now, all the cause of actions, if it is 10,000, and the cumulative becomes, for example, 10 lakhs, then the court with the pecuniary jurisdiction to hear cases of 10 lakhs, that is the court where you go to. That will be the jurisdiction of the court. Now, again, rule 6, you have to understand in a similar manner if such a joinder is causing embarrassing or delaying or making the trial inconvenient, the court may order separate trial. Now, what are certain claims? Rule 4 is giving you the claims that where you can join, what all you can join in a suit for recovery of immovable property. Here, you do not need the court's permission. This is one important. Here, you can add mean profits. You can add the cause of action for mean profits. You can add here claims of mean profit. You can add for the claims for the breach of contract on which, under which or a part of a property is held, or the claims based on the same cause of action. So for a suit for removal or immovable property, even without taking the court's permission, you can add these three particular claims according to Rule 4. Now, against Rule 5. Now, Rule 5 is for the claims that you're taking, that are taken by or against an executor, administrator, or heir. Now, you cannot, what is the basic principle behind is that you should maintain a distinction between their personal role and their roles in such capacity as an executor, administrator, or heir. So you cannot join their personal claims with such claims where they are representing in the manner of an executor, administrator, or heir, unless they are in reference to the estate which they are. Unless they are in reference to the estate which they are representing. If there's a claim, like they are the administrator of a particular piece of property, then and for the same piece of property, there is an allegation of misconduct on their part. That too can be joined. But however, he has a personal debt, and that cannot be joined in his capacity of whatever contract he's whatever suit he is actually representing, whatever suit where he is representing as an administrator. Or in the second case, where you can join his personal ones are also that, where he is entitled or liable for jointly with the person whose state they are representing. So rule number 5 is for executors, administrators, heirs. If claims against such persons personally should not be joined against the claims that are held in these capacities unless they are in reference to the estate which they are representing or where they are jointly entitled or liable with the persons whose estate they are representing and who is now deceased. That is rule number 5. Now, what are rule number 7 saying? Rule number 7 says that whatever objections you have to take as to misjoinder of cause of actions, again, take at the earliest or you deem it to be waived. So order 2 was about framing of suits. Order 1 was about parties to the suit. Order 1, you were talking about joinders of parties. Order 2, you're talking about joinders of cause of action. And cause of action, you saw how a suit should be framed in a manner which includes the entire claim. It should afford ground for the final decision. No fresh suit. If you are relinquishing a claim or a relief, or you are relinquishing that, you cannot come back with that. Which are the cases in which joinder of cause actions can be done? Again, the court here also has power to order separate trials, and one situation of recovery of immovable property where you can add certain claims without even taking the court's permission, and the rule number 5 for executors, administrators, or heirs, and rule number 7 when the objections as to misjoinder or cause of action should be taken. So this is multifariousness is also a name for the misjoinder of parties. You can find the terms in lots of places. So multifariousness is a misjoinder of parties where they are not needed in a case, but you have still joined them. That is multifariousness. Now you can see this. So today we have mostly covered 3 main topics, that how do you institute a suit? That would be section 26 and order 4. Then we have gone to parties to a suit, order 1. And then we have moved on to the third topic, that was the that was the framing of suit under Order 2. I hope this much is enough for today. Please let me know if I have made some errors or mistakes here and there. And please give me feedback on the same. I hope the audio is better than yesterday. I'm ending this class here. Next class, we would be dealing with pleadings, written statement and plaint. And if there are any other suggestions as to how should I conduct these classes, please let me know. Also, from the next class, I will try to include a video of myself speaking while during the lecture, as that has been a demand for a few of the people. And I hope there are no other problems and I have not made any mistake in the content. Please let me know if there is any, and thank you. Please like the video if you are liking the content being made, and share it with your friends, and do subscribe to the channel. Thank you.